ॐ वसुदेवसुतं देवं कंसचाणूरमर्दनं देवकी परमानंदं कृष्णं वंदे जगद्गुरुं असतो मा सद्गमय तमसो मा ज्योतिर्गमय मृत्योर्मामृतंगमय ओम शांति शांति शांति। Let us offer our salutations to Lord Krishna, the embodiment of bliss, who came to establish Dharma and punish the wicked. Let us pray to him to lead us from unreal to real, to lead us from darkness of ignorance to the light of knowledge, to lead us from death to immortality. We have been studying chapter 9, The Way of the Sovereign Wisdom and Sovereign Mystery. We are coming almost to the closing of the chapter. Chapter 9. In the last class we studied the verse number 31. Kshipram bhavati dharmatma shashvat shantim nigacchati kaunteya pratijanihi name bhakta pranashyati. Most inspiring message of Sri Krishna is here in this verse. A person who takes the name of the Lord will soon become righteous and he will attain eternal peace. O Arjun, know for certain that my devotee never perishes. This is a great assurance given by the Lord of the universe. He has specified in very clear terms, worship any god you want, there is no conflict, because Sri Krishna says all the forms of gods and goddesses are his own forms. He is taking numerous forms of gods and goddesses in order to satisfy the various temperaments of people. So that way God is very gracious, allowing us to choose according to our temperament, and God is ever ready to bestow his grace. Only point is, our devotion must be sincere and earnest, and everything will be taken care of. And here he says, even if a man is most wicked, committed criminal acts, even such a person, if he takes to the name, repeating the name of God, he will get rid of all these sinful tendencies. He will soon become Mahatma. Duratma becomes Mahatma. What more you want? Duratma, most wicked person, becomes a saint. So in the last class we have studied many incidents. Valmiki, who was once upon a time a dacoit, Jagaya Madai. So many incidents we have studied in the previous classes. And one more incident I am going to narrate now from the life of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. It's a most inspiring life. Those who are practicing Bhakti Yoga, they must read life of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Very inspiring. And his message was, he would tell them clearly, repeat God's name, repeat the name of Hari. Repeat. He would force them to repeat. Somehow he wants them to uplift them. Otherwise, where is the relief for such people who are always merged in the worldly ways and worldly behavior. So, here is an incident. Once upon a time, Gauranga Mahaprabhu was going in the street and chanting Hari's name, Hari Bol, Hari Bol. Then he came across a washerman. This is a famous incident. He was continuously beating the clothes on the stone. That is olden times, they didn't have washer, etc. So mechanically they would do. And he was vigorously beating the clothes. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu goes to him and tells him very kindly, look, tell the name of Hari. He thought this mendicant has come begging alms. So he said, sir, I am a very poor man. I have nothing to give you. He thought that Gauranga has come for asking some alms. Then Gauranga says, I don't want anything from you. Say Hari Bol. Repeat Hari. That's all I want. At least repeat once. The washerman still refused. He thought he would be required to pay something to the mendicant. Again he said, well, I am a very poor man. I can't give up beating the cloth in order to utter the name you have given to me. Then Gauranga goes further and tells him, look, I shall do the beating of the cloth. Please, please say Hari Om. Please say. He's requesting him. Then that mood is hard. Somehow, oh, this sadhu is telling me repeatedly, repeat, repeat. Why not I repeat? So he began to repeat Hari Bol. Then again Gauranga Mahaprabhu said, repeat twice. Then the washerman repeated twice. And once he repeated like this, Hari's name, in front of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the fire of devotion started. And thereafter he began to repeat and asked. Not only that, he began to dance in ecstasy, raising his hands, both the hands high up, repeating constantly Hari Bol, Hari Bol, like that. You should see in Calcutta how people dance chanting Hari Bol. I have seen there. I was there in Calcutta 2 years in training center. So we used to witness all these things. Very nice. So after some time, what happened? The wife of the washerman brought some food to give him. She saw, to her surprise, her husband was dancing with uplifted hands, continuously repeating Hari Bol, Hari Bol. And she also noticed that her husband had no consciousness of his surroundings. She was frightened. So immediately she ran to the village and said to the village people and neighbors, well, hear me, please, a ghost has taken possession of my husband. Please come immediately and help me. Drive away the ghost from him. So all the village people, they proceeded immediately to see the condition of the washerman. And they also saw that Vasudevan was still dancing and dancing in ecstasy. Virtually he was in a samadhi state. He was so much absorbed in his dancing and singing and chanting, these people became very much afraid to go near him. At last, a bold man got hold of the Vasudevan and tried to stop his dancing. As soon as this so-called hero began to touch the body of the Vasudevan, he too got some emotion and began to dance with the Vasudevan. And he also began to chant Hari Bol, Hari Bol. He embraced the onlookers. They too got emotion. They also began to dance in ecstasy. So the whole people of the village affected. They all began to dance and dance, repeating Hari Bol, Hari Bol. Gauranga Mahaprabhu was still there. He enjoyed the scene for some time. So, look at the power of the name of God. Power of the name of God. And that Vasudevan had no idea of God at all. You can call him atheist. That atheist became believer of God. And he would shed tears of joy by repeating Hari's name. So the Lord Krishna's teaching, repeat God's name. Repeat. Don't have any reservation. Don't feel shy. Keep repeating God's name. You'll be relieved from all the problems, sufferings, miseries in life. So that is the content of this verse. Now verse number 32. Maam hi partha vipashitya yepi syu papayonayaha striyo vaishyastatha chudrastepi yanti param gatim. Lord Krishna says further, for those who take refuge in me may be of sinful birth, may be they are women, vaishyas or shudras, and even persons of a sinful birth. But once they have taken refuge in me, verily they attain the supreme goal. So here Sri Krishna is telling that he rejects none. He accepts everybody, anybody and everybody. No exception. So, in this verse it is stated clearly that any person irrespective of caste, color or creed can attain liberation. Anyone who has great zeal, strong determination and established well in noble qualities will attain the supreme goal of life, namely the realization of Paramatman. There are many examples of how women got liberated. Gargi, Maitreyi, in the Upanishads, their names have come. They have reached the highest spiritual status. Another great woman, Sulabha, puts Janaka into a test regarding spiritual matters and certifies Janaka as a highly qualified spiritual person. In Jnana Vasishta, the woman Chudala teaches her totally ignorant husband about the supreme knowledge, adopting various forms of instructions. There are many, many great women saints such as Mirabai, Akka Mahadevi, a great Shiva saint in Karnataka, who attained liberation in their lifetime only through pure devotion. They didn't go for studying Vedas and under the teacher and acquire knowledge, etc. Just devotion, bhakti, that's all. And God accepted, God revealed. And another person, you may call it, classified as a Shudra, you may say. That means, Shudra is a person who has no samskara, a raw human being, you can say, raw, untrained, unclean. Such a person is called Shudra. He doesn't take bath, he doesn't wash his mouth, he eats all sorts of things, all dirty habits, drinking, etc., etc. Now, even those people are not rejected by God. Now, here is an example. A saint who became a saint, his name was Ravidas. He was a cobbler. But he became a saint not by studying the Vedas and scriptures, Upanishads, no. Just by doing Nama Japa of the Divine Name. Just by repeating God's name. Now there is another famous incident in the life of Sri Ramakrishna. The case of Rasik. He is a scavenger. You know, scavenger class people are untouchables. The idea, the reason is, they carry the excreta of human beings on their head. As I said, they don't take bath, etc. So, they were not touched by ordinarily by people. Those were days when low caste persons were treated very inhumanly. Even now people treat them like that. If a low caste man happened to cross an upper caste man's path, he would be punished. But no action could be taken against the latter. That was the condition in those days. Now Rasik, a scavenger, used to see many people coming to Sri Ramakrishna and receiving his blessings. He too wanted to go to him and ask for his blessings. The desire came to him, why not I go? But being untouchable, he dared not approach him in front of others. So, but he was just seriously, earnestly, he was thinking about Sri Ramakrishna, how to approach him, how to seek his blessings. One day, when Sri Ramakrishna was coming from the Panchavati, all by himself, there was nobody, alone. So that was the right opportunity, right moment. This scavenger immediately approached him. And he bent down his head and said, Father, oh Father, what will happen to me? Hearing his cry for spiritual grace, that moment Sri Ramakrishna went into deep samadhi and Rasik fell at his feet. After some time, when Sri Ramakrishna regained outer consciousness, he told Rasik, Rasik, don't be afraid. You will have it. At the time of death, you will see me. Don't worry. Exactly the same thing happened. Just before his death, he saw Sri Ramakrishna. It is recorded, it is not a story. And the face of this Rasik was beaming with delight. And he shouted, Oh Father, you have come? You have not forgotten me? Saying this, he passed away. We also find Sri Ramakrishna saying, Hazara said, that a man could not be liberated unless he was born in a Brahmin family. How is that? I said. Sri Ramakrishna said, one attains liberation through bhakti alone. Bhakti. And Sri Ramakrishna gives the example of Shabari. Shabari was the daughter of a hunter. She, as well as Rohidas and others, they belong to Shudra caste. They were all liberated through bhakti alone. Bhakti, bhakti, bhakti. Develop devotion. You will reach God. So, developing bhakti is most important. That is possible if you keep contact, coming to temple more often, more and more often, trying to understand spiritual ideas, trying to practice sincerely. God helps, really helps. Verse number 33, Kim Punarbrahmanaha Punya Bhakta Rajasayastata Anitya Musukam Lokam Imam Raprapya Bhajasvamam. What need then to mention the virtuous Brahmanas and devoted royal sages? Having come into this transient joyless world, worship me. Here the Brahmanas means not simply by birth. Brahmanas who are devoted to study of the Vedas, practice austerities, worship the divine and offer prayers daily, and the royal sages by virtue of their steady discrimination and determination, all such people are qualified and they attain the final goal of liberation. Being born in this world, which is subject to constant change and a place of miseries and sufferings, don't waste the precious time and human birth, but start worshipping me. Your purpose of human birth will then be rightly fulfilled. Start worshipping me, says Krishna. If you don't engage yourself in spiritual practices earnestly in this human life, then it will be a terrible loss and you will be again dragged into cycle of birth and death. You can't escape. That is, you are dropped again into samsara. Now the last verse number 34, Manmana Bhava Mad Bhakto Madhyaji Mam Namaskuru Mamevishis Yuktvayam Atmanam Matparayanaha. Now here is, in this chapter, he gives the final message. How to devote his time? How to develop devotion to Sri Krishna? He said, fix your mind on me. Be devoted to me. Sacrifice unto me. Bow down to me. 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 times it tells what to do. Having thus fixing your whole mind on me, taking me as the supreme goal, you shall verily come unto me. He has given full assurance, full hope. The whole being of a man should be surrendered to the Lord without reservation. Then there will be a marvelous transformation. He will have the vision of God everywhere. All sorrows and pains will vanish. His mind will be one with him. He will ever have his life and being in the Lord alone. He will forever have his life and being in the Lord alone. The first point he says, Lord Krishna, fix your mind on me. As I said, any God you are worshipping, fix your mind on that God. That is the idea. Sri Ramakrishna says in the Gospel, feel piqued at God and say to him, O God, you have created me. Now you must reveal yourself to me. Whether you live in the world or elsewhere, always fix your mind on God. These are the words of Sri Ramakrishna. Same thing in a different way, Sri Ramakrishna tells. Fixing the mind on God. The mind soaked in worldliness may be compared to a wet matchstick. You won't get a spark, however much you may rub it. Now, Ekalavya plays with the clay image of Drona, his teacher, in front of him, and thus learnt archery. The story is in the Mahabharata. Drona refused to teach Ekalavya archery because the Ekalavya belonged to a low caste. Thereupon, Ekalavya went to the forest, practiced archery before the clay image of Drona, whom he regarded as his teacher. In course of time, he became an expert archer. When Drona discovered that he excelled even Arjun, Drona's most beloved disciple, in this art, he asked Ekalavya to give him his thumb as a teacher's fee, Guru Dakshina. By carrying out this order, Ekalavya demonstrated his spirit of self-sacrifice and also his love for his teacher. That was the story of Ekalavya, and he has become immortal. In another place, Sri Ramakrishna says, he says to other, always keep your mind fixed on God. In the beginning, you must struggle a little. Later on, you will enjoy your pension. So, struggling has got a value. If you don't struggle at all, you won't get anything. Be sure of that. You have to get everything by your effort. Effort must be done. Grace follows the effort. You can't simply expect the grace without doing anything. Idle man doesn't get any grace. He doesn't recognize also. So, grace is always followed by effort, effort. Constant effort. Keep on doing. M. Master Mahashay, he asked Master, sir, may we fix our minds on God? How, sir? How may we fix our minds on God? Sri Ramakrishna replied, repeat God's name and sing His glories and keep holy company and now and then visit God's devotees and holy men. The mind cannot dwell on God if it is immersed day and night in worldliness, in worldly duties and worldly responsibilities. It is most necessary to go into solitude now and then and think of God. To fix the mind on God is very difficult in the beginning unless one practices meditation in solitude. When a tree is young, it should be fenced all around, otherwise it may be destroyed by cattle. To meditate, you should withdraw within yourself or retire to a secluded corner, to the forest, and you should always discriminate between the real and the unreal. God alone is real, the eternal substance. All else is unreal, that is impermanent. By discriminating thus, one should shake off impermanent objects from the mind. Master Mahashay again asked the question, Master, how are we to live in the world? Sri Ramakrishna replied, do all your duties, but keep your mind on God. Live with all, with family and children, parents, serve them. Treat them as if they were very, very dear to you. But know in your heart of hearts that they don't belong to you. A maid servant in the house of a rich man performs all the household duties, but her thoughts are fixed on her own home in her native village. She brings up her master's children as if they were her own. She even speaks of them as my Rama, oh, my Hari. But in her own mind she knows very well that they do not belong to her at all. Sri Ramakrishna gives another example. The tortoise moves about in the water. But can you guess where her thoughts are? There on the bank where her eggs are lying. Do all your duties in the world, but keep your mind on God. If you enter the world without first cultivating love for God, you will be entangled more and more. You will be overwhelmed with this danger. its grief and its sorrows. And the more you think of worldly things, the more you will be attached to them. So, first rub your hands with oil and then break open the jackfruit. Otherwise they will be smeared with its sticky milk. First secure the oil of divine love and then set your hands to the duties of the world. But one must go into solitude or temples where there is divine atmosphere to acquire this divine love. To get butter from milk, you must let it set into curd in a secluded spot. If it is too much disturbed, milk won't turn into curd. Next, you must put aside all other duties, sit in a quiet spot and churn the curd. Only then do you get butter. Further, by meditating on God in solitude, the mind acquires knowledge, dispassion and devotion. But the very same mind goes downward if it dwells in the world. In the world, there is only one thought, lust and gold. And there is one, a great devotee of in Chicago. I was in Institute of Culture before coming to Chicago here. I was in Institute of Culture, Calcutta. And this lady came to visit Belur Math. And she's an American. So she stayed in the Institute of Culture, Gold Park. Because she was a devotee, she came to see me. And we were talking. Then she says, Swamiji, what is there in America? She's an American lady. What is there in America? Sex and money. Sex and money. Nothing else. Her words. I was surprised to hear such words from her. Anyway, same thing Sri Ramakrishna is telling here. In the world there is only one thought, lust and gold, nothing else. The more they think of wealth, the more they want to acquire wealth. They want to have more and more hold about the wealth. They don't want to give up even a cent. Too much pain to them. More and more hold, deep hold. Like that. And that hold continues till the hour of death. Even then the hold will not go. Anyway, the world is water and the mind milk. If you pour milk into water, they become one. You cannot find the pure milk anymore. But turn the milk into curd and churn it into butter. Then when that butter is placed in water, it will float. So practice the spiritual discipline in solitude and obtain the butter of knowledge and love. Even if you keep that butter in the water of the world, the two will not mix. The butter will float. Together with this, you must practice discrimination. Lust and gold is impermanent. God is the only eternal substance. What does a man get with money? Food, clothes and a dwelling place, nothing more. You cannot realize God with itself. Therefore, money can never be the goal of life. That is the process of discrimination. Do you understand? So Sri Ramakrishna is asking M. M said, yes sir, I recently read a Sanskrit play called Prabodha Chandrodaya. It deals with discrimination. Master said, yes, discrimination about objects. Consider, what is there in money or in a beautiful body? Discriminate and you will find that even the most beautiful body consists of bones, flesh, fat and other disagreeable things. Why should a person give up God and direct his attention to such things? Why should a person forget God for that sake? Master said to the actor, your acting was very good, If a person excels in singing, music, dancing, or any other art, he can also quickly realize God, provided he strives sincerely. Just as you practice much in order to sing, dance, and play on instruments, so one should practice the art of fixing the mind on God. One should practice regularly such disciplines as worship, japa, and meditation. It has to be done. No excuse. So that is the first point. Fix your mind on me. The second point Sri Krishna highlights, be devoted to me. Sri Ramakrishna says in the Gospel, one must not cherish any desire whatever. The devotion of a man who has any desire is selfish. But desireless devotion is love for its own sake. You may love me or not, but I love you. This is love for its own sake. The thing is that one must love God. Through intense love, one attains the vision of Him. The attraction of the husband for the chaste wife, the attraction of the child for its mother, the attraction of worldly possessions for the worldly man. When a man can blend these three into one and direct it all to God, then he gets the vision of God. Third point, sacrifice unto me. Again, Sri Ramakrishna says, it is not any dry and every kind of bhakti that enables one to realize God. One cannot realize God without prema bhakti. Another name for prema bhakti is raga bhakti. God cannot be realized without love and longing. Unless one has learned to love God, one cannot realize Him. There is another kind of bhakti known as vaidhi bhakti, according to which one must repeat the name of God a fixed number of times, fast, make pilgrimages, worship God with prescribed offerings, make so many sacrifices and so forth and so on. By continuing such practices a long time, one gradually acquires raga bhakti. God cannot be realized until one has raga bhakti. One must love God. In order to realize God, one must be completely free from worldliness and direct all one's mind to Him. But some acquire raga bhakti directly. It is innate in them. They have it from their very childhood. Even at an early age, they weep for God. An instance of such bhakti is to be found in Prahlada. The life of Prahlada, great story in Mahabhagavat. Vaidhi bhakti is like moving a fan to make a breeze. One needs the fan to make the breeze. Similarly, one practices japa, austerity and fasting in order to acquire love of God. Devotion to God may be said to be green so long as it doesn't grow into love of God. But it becomes ripe when it has grown into such love. A man with green bhakti cannot assimilate spiritual talk and instruction, but one with ripe bhakti can. The image that falls on a photographic plate covered with black film is retained. On the other hand, thousands of images may be reflected on a bare piece of glass, but not one of them is retained. As the object moves away, the glass becomes the same as it was before. One cannot assimilate spiritual instruction unless one has already developed love of God. Vijaya Goswami asks a question, Sir, is bhakti alone sufficient for the attainment of God, for His vision? Sri Ramakrishna said, yes, one can see God through bhakti alone, but it must be ripe bhakti, prema bhakti and raga bhakti. When one has that bhakti, one loves God. When one has such love and attachment for God, one doesn't feel the attraction of maya to family, relatives and friends. One retains only compassion for them. To such a person, the world appears a strange land, a place where he has merely to perform his duties. It is like a man's having his real home in the country, but coming to Calcutta for work. He has to rent a house in Calcutta for the sake of his duties. When one develops love of God, one completely gets rid of one's attachment to the world and worldly wisdom. The next important point Sri Krishna highlights in this verse is, bow down to me, or Namaskuru. Sri Ramakrishna arrived at Govinda Mukherjee's house at Belgaria near Calcutta. Besides Narendra Ram and other devotees, some of Govinda's neighbors were present. The master first sang and danced with devotees. After the kirtan, they sat down. Many saluted the master. Now and then, Sri Ramakrishna would say, bow down before God, bow down before God. Mam Namaskuru. Same thing Sri Ramakrishna says in the Gospel. Bow down to God. He repeats 2-3 times. Bow before God. So that concludes this chapter. Chapter 9. The Yoga of the Sovereign Wisdom and Sovereign Mystery, where Lord Krishna has given assurance to every one of us to approach Him. So there should not be any difficulty for practicing spiritual life. If you are a human being, that's enough. This is the only qualification required. Whether you are a man or woman, doesn't matter. You may belong to any community, it doesn't matter. You are a human being. So divert our all attention towards developing devotion to God. That takes care of everything. In order to do that, you must develop detachment towards the world and attachment towards God. Turn all your attachment towards God. Engage yourself in more and more selfless activities. Try to cultivate the nature of sacrifice. Try to get rid of selfishness instead of covering it up. So the sign of becoming more and more devoted to God, less and less worldly. What do you mean by less and less worldly? Less and less worldly means less and less selfishness. Less and less selfish. The more you are coming towards God, the more you are selfless. That means you love everyone on this earth. That's the idea. So next Tuesday we shall start chapter 10, the Yoga of Divine Manifestations. Om Vasudeva Sutam Devam कंसचाणूरमर्दनम् देवकी परमानंदम् कृष्णं वंदे जगद्गुरुम्. Let us offer our services to Lord Krishna, the embodiment of bliss, who came to establish dharma and punish the wicked. Peace, peace, peace be unto all.